అఖండమండలాకారం వ్యాప్తం ఏన చరాచరం తత్పదం దర్శితం ఏన తస్మై శ్రీగురవే నమః అజ్ఞానతిమిరాంధస్య జ్ఞానాంజనం శలాకయ చక్షురుమిలితం ఏన తస్మై శ్రీగురవే నమః గురుర్బ్రహ్మ గురుర్విష్ణు గురుర్దేవో మహేశ్వర గురుర్సాక్షాత్ పరబ్రహ్మ తస్మై శ్రీగురవే నమః You can't start anything without Guru Vandana, going down to the Guru. Because whatever I have here or here or wherever, and which you are able to hear today, I am going to talk to you and reproduce, is because of the gracious hand of Maheshwarnath Babaji that was laid on my head at the age of 9. So every time before I start anything, I would like to do the Guru Vandana, and that's what I did just now. Now the topic today is
Yoga, the dynamic science of living.
Yoga, I had it in my pocket, I forgot. Yoga, the dynamic science of living, so that's what it is. So first of all, I'm sure there are some question answers, but first of all, let's look at the words yoga, life, and dynamics. These are the three things put together. Yoga, the dynamic science of living. So first, we need to rule out that yoga is not a passive state. It's not a state which is resorted to by lazy people who don't want to do anything else. It's actually a super active state, but action in tranquility and quietness of mind without agitation. So, this is what we are going to discuss today. I will come to the practical aspects, not that we are going to do the head down posture here, but we will come to the practical aspects of it at the end. But oh, sorry to greet you, ladies and gentlemen, and the High Commission representative, and Lady Mohini, who introduced me, and all of you who are here, good friends, good sisters, brothers, everybody. So first we will deal with something which is around maybe 1,000 years old before we go to the practical aspects of yoga as it is today. But what I'm trying to say is that even 1,000 years ago, yoga was a dynamic practice. It was not something meant for people just sitting in the caves and meditate. It's not like sometimes young men come to me and say, I want to give up all work. What's your age? 26. I want to give up everything. Why? Because I want to practice yoga. I tell them, listen, yoga is not meant for somebody who has lost his job or who doesn't want to work. Yoga is a state of mind which is to be cultivated. We'll come to that. So anyway, 1,000 years ago, I don't know, there is a lot of historical discussion on this. Some people say 800, some 2000, it doesn't matter really. There was this wonderful book, well, it's considered a scripture. When you go to study the science of Vedanta, there is what is called the Prasthanatraya, which means the three important curriculum to be mastered, of which one, of course, is the Upanishads, then there is the Brahma Sutras, and in the middle comes the Bhagavad Gita. Now the importance is, Upanishads are abstract, actually not so abstract, but we have been made to believe that they are too abstract and not for ordinary. It's not true, they're actually very direct. There may be some Upanishads which are, but generally. Now the Brahma Sutras are really abstract. What happens to a work which begins by saying, now let us look into the Brahman. I mean, first you don't know what is the Brahman, where do we start, what do we do? However, the Bhagavad Gita, which comes in the middle, you know, something in the tea. This is a particular text authored by Vedavyasa, in which it's the famous battle of Kurukshetra, and how the message of yoga, if you ask me, is Gita yoga? I would say yes. I can quote Gita for you. At the end of every chapter of the Gita, Vyasa says, Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita, so this is the Bhagavad Gita. Upanishadsu, it is the knowledge of the Upanishad. Yoga Shastri, it is the practice of the yoga or the practice of the techniques called yoga. Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvade, dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna. So, the Bhagavad Gita can be by its own declaration considered to be a good textbook for yoga. So, Yoga Shastri. So now, just think of where the Gita was supposed to have been preached. People always ask, is it possible to preach something in the middle of a battle? Well, you can say that Vyasa did it in such a way that you understand that yoga is worth practicing only if you can practice it in the middle of the battle of life. We all have some battles, right? Outside, at home, with the taxi, with the camera. We have our little battles and our bigger battles, political battles, philosophical battles. We have this every time. So we live in this world which has two sides, two opposites. And because there are two sides, there is conflict. One pulling this way, the other pulling the other. So in the midst of this battle of Kurukshetra, is it possible to lead a life which can be considered yogic? This is the question. Not run away from it. In fact, if you read the Gita, in every chapter it is stressed, this yoga is not for him who stops all activity. This yoga is not for him who runs away from home. I did run away when I was young, that's a different story. Adventure. This yoga is not for him who shuns his duties or doesn't work and is lazy. This yoga is for him who is in the middle of the battlefield of life and yet knows how to handle it. This is stressed, you look, any chapter of the Gita. But then since we are dealing with the Gita, I want to start with the first chapter. Now the first chapter of the Gita is called Arjuna Vishad Yoga. You know what Vishada means? It means the sorrow of Arjuna, or the uncertainty of Arjuna, or the insect, you know, Sanskrit, when you say Vishada, it could mean many things. So it's an ancient language, more ancient than English, so you need more words to describe that word. Although the fact remains that the best and the first dictionary of Sanskrit into English was written by a Britisher called Sir Monier Williams. It's still a classic. How he worked so hard and got it done, I don't know, but it is there for us. So anyway, even I refer sometimes. So here you have Arjuna Vishada Yoga, the yoga of Arjuna's dissatisfaction, discomfort, sorrow, insecurity, uncertainty. You can put all these things together. And therefore I say that it's for all of us. Because at some point of life or another, we are in that state of indecisiveness, insecurity. Sometimes, you know, we are overburdened with sorrow. And there sits Arjuna asking Krishna, now what do I do? Do I run away from the battle? Or do I understand myself so that I know what to do and what not to do, actually? First he says, I'm going to run away. And Krishna says to him, what's gone wrong with you? You were okay till the last minute. This is fear that you might fail that is stopping you, not anything else. Don't think you're on a moral high. you are afraid that you might lose and become and shamed by losing the battle, which is why you're thinking of running away from this. Now this is the same with life. Consider the Kurukshetra war. Well, Kurukshetra war might have happened, I'm not talking about that. But we have this daily Kurukshetra going on in our lives. And the way is not to run from it, but to face it. And therefore the Gita is a message given by Krishna to Arjuna, how to handle this battle and how to come out successful and perform perfectly in this battle, and at the same time allow the mind to go to the essence and core of one's consciousness. Now, all our problems are because we don't touch that. We are satisfied with these little things. It's good to eat popcorn, but not too much. There are some more important things to be done in life. So anyway, so this is the teaching, starting with Arjuna's sorrow. Why Arjuna's sorrow? Because it's only when a little bit of sorrow strikes, even a little bit, that human beings begin to question life. If everything was hunky-dory, nobody would question life, you'd carry on. Have your ice cream, go to sleep, you're okay, happy, fine. But when sorrow strikes you in some way, which is inevitable, it can happen at any time to anybody, then you begin to call on God, call on the Guru, call, you know, the whole thing. What to do now, please help me. I get about 200, 300, 400 emails every day saying what to do. I said, do what you should be doing. I mean, what else can I say? Anyway, so this is the story of the Gita. And as it progresses, the next chapter is Sankhya Yoga, which means the description of knowledge. Then Karma Yoga, which means how to live in this world and still not get caught up by it. Because if you get caught up by it, then this life becomes worthless. It's terrible. So can you live, do your work and not get caught up in this, what in Hindi we call the chakkar. Don't get fussed in the chakkar, but still continue to live in this world and do your work. If yoga was something other than this, it's not worth it, because we cannot escape. We cannot go off to the cave. We cannot live away from society. We have to live here. So living here, how is it possible? What is the knowledge required? That's called the Sankhya Yoga. And how to apply it to your daily life is Karma Yoga. And then from there it goes on to other chapters like Dhyana Yoga, which is how to meditate, and so on. Now, since we are on this subject, I'll come back to now. But then, like yesterday somebody said, now is a result of yesterday. We can discard yesterday as a memory, but it's still, today is a product of yesterday. So since we are in the past with the Gita, what we are today may be a result of this past in some way. So, before we again come to the present, let me again deal a little more with the Gita. Now, there are beautiful chapters in the Gita. Some of them are really, you should read it. Fortunately, you have English translations. Fortunately, because nowadays nobody reads Sanskrit. If you are a Sanskrit scholar, you're probably assured of not getting a job. That's the situation. And in India, it's been completely neglected. Coming up slowly, but it's been neglected. And in fact, when I went to Germany, I found that the University of Berlin has two chairs for Sanskrit, with two professors sitting there who are not Indians, but Germans, fluently conversing in Sanskrit. I was a little taken aback. But we don't have, so depend on the translations, my dear friends from India. So, as you go along, one of the chapters which will be interesting to you from the practical point of view of day-to-day life would be the Dhyana Yoga chapter. Chapter on meditation. And then the other, which interests me the most, is the 12th chapter called Bhakti Yoga. When does it try? You know, it's very interesting. This is where yoga moves from daily work and how to remain working and at the same time not getting caught, to how to go deeper into the core of your consciousness and expand. How to tap the infinite potential that's in all of us. In a small way, when I live my life, I actually feel this happening. Because to be honest, today for instance, even though yesterday morning I knew what the talk was, I forgot. I came in. It's not a good thing, of course. But then you don't need it. Because if your mind is clear, like a clean slate, then concentrate on the subject at hand and what you need will come inside. Which means, what I'm trying to say is that there is a vast potential of all kinds in our consciousness. We've not tapped it because we use a limited part of our brains. And the science of yoga is how to explore the larger horizons. How to tap that part of your system by which you can reach out to the infinite potential. You may not become the infinite, but you can certainly reach out to parts of that infinite. Okay. So, the 12th chapter. I love the 12th chapter because some people think it's a chapter meant for simple folk who don't have any knowledge and so on. Bhakti yoga. Because when you hear bhakti, people think, oh, this is for simpletons, not for serious people. Because the yoga of devotion. But that's not so. The reason why Krishna in the Gita, or maybe Vedavyasa, if you don't want to think Krishna was sitting there, then Vedavyasa, waits till the 12th chapter to talk about devotion. Why couldn't he have said that in the beginning if it's so important? The reason is, first, one wakes up only when one has sorrow, like Arjuna has, and insecurity. And two, because till chapter 10 and 11, everything is like Krishna talks, Arjuna listens, and so on and so forth. Arjuna asks questions, Krishna answers them. Krishna is riding, Arjuna is sitting on the chariot, Krishna sits with the reins of the horses in his hands. So it's all quite normal, like you're sitting here and I'm talking to you. Then suddenly, in chapter 10, Krishna changes his, what we call, changes the record. Changes the, you know, we had this old LP, so one side is one thing, the other side. So he changes the record and comes to the other side. And then Arjuna for some time is confounded because this man, who is also his friend and is a relative, and who is his charioteer, imagine I have a driver, a chauffeur, who is driving me, and the chauffeur, good chauffeur, let's say, and the chauffeur suddenly turns around and says, you know who I am? I'm the son. I'd probably get out of the car and run off. You don't know where he's going to take us. But suddenly, in the 10th chapter, Krishna says to Arjuna, things which Arjuna never thought could be said by this figure sitting here in front, with the reins of the horses in his hand, he says, among the immovables, I am the Himalayas. You know the word Hima means snow. And Alaya means house of snow. It also called Himachala, which means the immovable snow-clad peaks. So he says, among the immovables, I am the Himachala. Achala means that which doesn't move, steady. Then he says, among the great munis, I am Kapila. Arjuna is wondering, what's happened to this guy? Till now he was talking to me in normal terms, and then he suddenly says, among the Vedas, I am the Samaveda. Among the mountains, I am the Meru, which is the North Pole. So what's happening here is slowly Krishna releases an element of surprise and confusion into Arjuna's mind, where he begins to question his ordinary logic. You know, we have this normal logic. 1 plus 1 is equal to 2. It can't be other than that. Although we know now that as you go further up into advanced science, nothing is certain. But we like our certainty. When you study Newtonian physics, everything appears certain. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction, and so on and so forth. And then slowly, and everything is made up of atoms and so on. Then you go into quantum physics. Suddenly you come across something which is complete uncertainty. The tiniest building blocks of this world, of this universe, nobody knows today. All the certainty of Newtonian physics has vanished. Nobody knows today. It's not my opinion. I've met many physicists and talked to them. Whether the smallest building block, the quantum particle, because the moment you say particle, it behaves like a wave. And if you think it's a wave, it behaves like a particle. Even some scientists have gone to the extent of saying it depends on the observer. Not completely accepted, of course. These physicists take a long time to accept, which is good. I'm not saying it's bad, but people like David Bohm, the physicist, have agreed that perhaps it depends on the observer. So the observer, who is subjective, becomes more important than that which is observed. So why did I say that?
Sense of surprise.
Surprise, yeah. So Arjuna is made suddenly aware of the uncertainty of defining who is this guy sitting in front of me. Because you can't suddenly say, I am the Meru and I am the Himalayas and I am so and so. Okay. Then while his so-called logical framework is being given a little shake, because our logical framework is based on only the inputs that come from our 5 sense organs. No other inputs are available to us. Anyway, we'll come to that later. So, while he is thinking about that, there comes the next chapter when Krishna suddenly changes his shape. And Arjuna sees many worlds coming into him and going out. He sees all the gods in him. He sees the kind of a thunder and lightning, and there is a lot of something. There is no more this Krishna who is playing the flute. There is something formidable in front of him. Then, at that time, his complete so-called rational design, blueprint, which he had created till then, vanishes. Then Krishna says, okay, so there is something which is beyond your ordinary logic. And that, the good news, Arjuna, is it is nowhere to be searched outside. It is inside you. Don't worry. You can find it in you. And if you find it in you, it can be found in anybody, because you are not unique. As a human being, everybody has that which, when touched, is the essence of all being, which is universal, which has extensive and infinite potentials, although our limited brain may not be able to bring down everything from there, but at least something. And then goes on to Sannyas Yoga, which is the last chapter, where Krishna again defines sannyasa as not giving up and running away, but to be able to live without being affected by pleasure or pain, praise or blame, heat or cold. Now this is very interesting to note, you know. This is coming slowly to the practical aspect. We live in this world, in this tumultuous world, so dependent on what others think about us. If I think I'm a wise man, suppose I think I'm a wise man, and somebody says he's a bloody fool, what happens to me? I'm down. And then somebody came and said, no, don't worry, and praises me. Yesterday somebody told me, 5 hours somebody was criticizing, I felt so happy and thrilled. Because criticism shows what your problems are. And you should actually worship those who criticize. The gods come in human form to show you where you go wrong. Right? So, what happened? So why did I say that? Interact, please.
So, somebody praises you, you're on a high, somebody says you're full, if you know.
Yes. So this is our life. We depend on what others think about ourselves. So we need to show off. I mean, no, I'm wise. I'm not an idiot. Because, you don't know, our lives are up and down. What's that thing they have in circuses? Huh?
Well,
yeah. What is it called?
Roller coaster.
Our life is a roller coaster of ups and downs. When things are bad, I mean, when we think things are bad, nothing is bad really, then we are down. And we think things are rosy, we are up. So we live in this flux. The whole question of yoga is it possible to live in this world which is full of flux and still maintain your tranquility and your mind in peace without being affected? Actually, if you look carefully, it all depends on the wonderful framework that we have networked and created with language. Because what does it matter if somebody calls me a fool if I don't know English? I don't know English. Somebody says, you're a fool. I say, yeah, okay. So, if I know only Hindi, I might think you're calling me a fool, flower. So you see how language is built. This language is important. If I didn't know English, I can't communicate with you. Okay, agreed. Having said that, it can be applied where you want and not taken to limits of psychological dependence where you don't need it. So, like, you know how people gravitate towards those who speak one language. I'm sure even here, when the talk is over and we go out, you'll see the Malayalam speaking in one group, the non-Malayalam speaking in one group. So, the Hindi speaking in one group, somebody says, Kemcho, Majama. So, it happens because we have languages. And languages are good, but they can also be detrimental to understanding in the sense they divide sometimes. So, anyway. So, if one can live in the midst of all this, understanding that it doesn't matter what other people think about you, you know what you are. Let's stay there. And if you have problems, if somebody criticizes, you accept it, because give it thought, because you might be able to repair the damage which has been caused to you till then. It's quite possible that you might figure out what to do now. So don't get upset. If one can give praise and blame, pleasure and pain, you know, is always there. If you think you eat a lot of ice cream and you have a bad throat the next day, it was simple. You have a lot of money and the income tax is knocking at your door. You say you have a beautiful wife and you have to be careful of your neighbor. Normal. So, pleasure and pain, praise and blame, heat and cold is part of the world. You can't escape or run away from it. You can't say, I will always be like happy with no bad circumstance. Impossible. However, yoga is the secret of how to live in the midst of this and yet be happy and free and not get caught up by this roller coaster of depression and excitement. Excitement and depression are the major causes of blood pressure, BP. Look, I'm not boasting. I am now 69 years almost. People say I keep increasing every year, but 69, let's say. Till today, I personally, and I'm not taking any medicines, I don't have either high blood pressure. When I go, people give me tea and there should be put sugar in this. They might be thinking this guy must be having diabetes. Luckily, I don't. I'm okay. Now, there are two reasons for this. One is the practical aspect. We're coming to that from here to now. Try to live a life of moderation. Don't go into extremes. Neither too much nor too little. Gita, Krishna says in the Gita, this yoga is not for him who eats too much or eats too little. I can see my friends, some of them here, whom I had met many years ago, and who were very fit because they are working in the police. And now you see them, I know how much they must be eating, where the tummy is in front, 2 feet away. No work, no exercise, more food. So if you can control and moderate your life, neither too much nor too little. It's not easy, but it can come through practice. And abhyasa, or practice, is an important part of yoga. I'm talking about dynamic yoga, yoga for daily life. It's not just enough to stand on your head. That's not just yoga. That's the asanas, the postures, which are good, of course. I'm not denying that. But apart from that, there are other aspects of yoga which you have to look into. And that is, first, to understand the fact that apart from the conditioned reflexes and the conditioned thought process that we have created in our lives, there is an element in us which is free of all limitations. And if you can even in a small way tap into that, you have infinite potentials. I am saying this especially to the young. Old people, well, fuel is already mostly worked out, so we can't. But there are old people who are physically old but mentally young. I know people, I met yogis who are almost 100 years old. Talk to them, their brains, their minds, they're like 20-year-old, always curious to know what is new, always keeping their minds open, open to discussion. Now this kind of thing is possible in yoga. If yoga has to be dynamic, that's what we are looking for. Yoga shouldn't turn you into some kind of a zombie. That's not the aim of yoga. Yoga is when you want, you can sit and touch the core of your consciousness. And when you're outside the world, you can tap the potential that you have created by going deep with it. Therefore, the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali define yoga as yoga chitta vritti nirodha, which means yoga is the stilling of the distractions of the mind. Stilling of the distractions of the mind stuff. When the distractions are stilled, first thing that happens, the first thing is that it is through distraction that you lose energy. A mind without distraction is full of energy. There is no loss. And what you are seeking, the essence of your being, needs a great deal of energy to explore. A distracted mind cannot explore it. So the training of yoga, even the asanas, the pranayama, the breathing, the meditation practices, everything is basically to make your mind tranquil and quiet at any given moment and survive in this world of ups and downs without being caught up in it. And therefore, work very efficiently in this world. I don't know if you know that even now, I think I work almost 18-19 hours. People say you can say all this, but what is the proof? Here is the proof. Why am I traveling or road over again? Why can't I stay in Madhapali happily? Because my happiness is not dependent on Madhapali. It's dependent on my inner self and state of being. And the good news is that all of you have the same. In all of you, there is this core You may call it Atma, you may call it your mind, you may call it the core of it, you can use any term you like. But there is a potential in us which is not only tranquil, calm, blissful and quiet, but at the same time, which has tremendous potential, which can be tapped and made useful for this world at large. I'll give you an example. There was Swami Vivekananda. He passed away, he died at the age of, I said passed away because in India it's not good to say Yogi died. Anyway, he passed away. And everybody dies, of course, but it's a nice way of putting it, passed away. At the age of, I think, 39. In this 39 years, I think he had done work which would have been impossible for 1,000 people working for 100 years. Some people say he exhausted himself. I don't believe it. I think he, when he found this is enough for this time being, he vanished. He went. So, to conclude this talk, because we have a small question and answer session. One, yoga is not an exotic something which is confined to the caves and ashrams. Yoga is a day-to-day living, how to live in the world without excesses in a balanced way. How to, while living in this world of ups and downs and pains and pleasures, how to keep your mind tranquil. And that when the mind is tranquil, then you touch the essence of your being. And the essence of your being is an infinite something with vast potential. Every time somebody does a thing which is extraordinary, it's simply that by accident or through deliberation, they have tapped a little bit of that potential from the essence. And finally, the good news is that is inside us. You don't have to search for it anywhere outside. But somebody declared that it is nearer to you than your own jugular vein. You can call it Brahman, you can call it the Supreme Being, you can call it just like the Jains have no Ishvara, no God concept. They say Nirvana. Buddhists say Shunya. It's the same. Junya is not nothing. It's that from which this whole world has come and which it goes back. So it can't be nothing. It's maybe no thing. Because there is an essence in us which cannot be detected by our five senses. And all the world that we have, I was just reading a book a friend gave me on neurotheology. He said, we don't know the world that we live in. We only know the impressions given to us by the sense organs and processed by the brain into an idea. We really don't know how something is. This is the world we live in. So can we live in the essence of it instead of getting caught up in the externals and still be able to survive and function in this world? If you do that, I think every one of you can turn out to be some kind of a genius in some field. Even if you don't turn into a genius, you live a world of happiness and tranquility without interfering and stepping on other people's toes. You have a peaceful world. So, I rest my argument. Thank you. Thank you. Those who have questions can be given a microphone. Sure. So that they can, everybody can hear the question. If it is anything secret, then I won't discuss it. Are you okay with the recording? No disturbance?
If this world is a dream, as it is said, how do we wake up from this dream?
Give me that, please. Now this is a very philosophical, in-depth, speculative question, but then, since it's there, I don't know if I'm going to finish the question time with this. If you really are serious, let's go into this. Careful. If this world is a dream, it's not actually practical yoga, but something to do with your understanding, which is important. If this world is, first of all, is it a dream? So somebody says, is this world a dream as it is referred? Referred where? Referred in some books, maybe. I didn't say that anyway. How do we wake up from this dream? Now let's examine this thing called dream. Now, while we are dreaming, I'm not talking about this world as a dream, our dreams, actual dreams, sopnavastha, the dream state. While we are dreaming, do we know that we are dreaming? I mean, rarely sometimes, but generally, while we are dreaming, there's a tiger chasing me. No, I know it's a dream. No, I'm running for my life. Right? And then when I wake up, I think, oh my God, this was a dream. And it was so real that I'm still palpitating and perspiring. Right? What would have happened if this dream continued for a longer time? I would still have been chased by a tiger or maybe eaten up by the tiger. When I wake up, I would discover, no, I'm not. Dream, actual dream, which we all experience. We are asking, who knows? This is for the first part of the sentence. Who knows? Maybe one day, stretch our hands and rub our eyes and look at this life and say, oh my God, what a big dream. If I say that now, you wouldn't believe it, because in a dream, you will never believe it's a dream. It's only when you wake up that you think it's a dream. It's a common experience, everybody's experience. Perhaps this is a long dream. Perhaps when you wake up you think it's a dream. There's nothing wrong with a dream. We enjoy dreams, right? Sometimes, especially if they are good dreams. Like you're in heaven and people are pouring goblets of wine for you. Enjoy dreams. We give up everything here, but there are apsaras looking after you there. We enjoy the dream, right? But when you wake up, what happens? You say it's all vanished. In the same way, the great Upanishads and the great yogis said, there is a trigger, there is a way by which, if you can go into the core of your consciousness, from where dream, waking state, deep sleep, everything originates. And then you are woken up from this long dream and you are free. But to do that, the first step of course is to make your mind tranquil and quiet, and that's practical yoga, the yoga of meditation. So the first step, the tarmac from which you need to take off to this understanding, is a quietness and tranquility of mind, which I think anyone can acquire with a little bit of effort. If you're not prepared to take that effort, well, you can't blame anybody else. You're prepared to work very hard to make money. Why not? Why should this be just a hobby? If it's a serious affair, when you question the whole structure of life, it might be serious. So if you put in a little effort, then it is possible to figure out how to, but first theoretically understand that just like a dream becomes a dream when you wake up, perhaps there is a state where you wake up from here and think that this is a dream. That's why some people said it's a dream, not because it's not real. As of now, if you are hungry, you have to eat. So it's not a dream in the absolute sense of the term, but relatively it's a dream. That's what it meant.
How to find the purpose of life and what's the best way?
How to find one's purpose of life? What is the best way to find it? Now you see, this question you have to probably ask yourself, what is the purpose of my life? What is the purpose of my life? Is it merely to grow up, make money, get married, have kids? I'm not against that, I'm married, I have two kids. Or, and have more and more houses. Or buy the latest sports car. What is the aim of my life? What is the purpose of my life? Does that give me happiness? So if you look carefully, So if you look carefully, you will see that there is only one purpose in life for everybody. You'll be wondering, what is this? How can this be? I want to become an actor, I want to become an accountant, I want to become a businessman, and so on and so forth. Nobody wants to become a yogi. You think we have different purposes in life, but if you look closely, the whole thing boils down to just one purpose, which is how to make myself happy or happier, or if I'm incomplete, how to make myself complete. Is there some way in which I can fulfill the gaps in my life? Is there some way in which I can remain satisfied forever? This is the aim of life, this is the purpose of life. We may think it will happen if I become an actor or if I become, well, a politician. I personally think most politicians, I don't know if anybody is here, I'm sorry. Most politicians must be taking sleeping medicines to sleep. Because you don't know, you're not sure what's going to happen the next day. So, the purpose in life is to find lasting happiness, whatever you do. And all that we do is because of that. So I'm saying, while you continue to pursue your interests, while you continue to do what you think suits you in life, as long as you're not stepping on other people's toes, if doing that, meanwhile, if you have the understanding, then the real purpose of life is to find happiness which can't be shaken by any outward circumstances. And then, while you are up doing your things, whatever you're doing, also spend some time to go within you and give 10 or 15 minutes at least to keep quiet and look within yourself. If you do that, you will begin to understand the purpose of life. And if you touch that happiness, then there is nothing to worry. You can do everything, but you can still be in that. In fact, when you touch that, you also kind of tap your infinite potential and probably use it for your purposes. But remember, not causing harm to others. I think that's all I can say for this question. It's a general question. I try to be as specific as I can.
Does God exist?
Very serious question. We should ask Richard Dawkins. The God delusion. Well, let me tell you this. When you say God, different people have different ideas about God. Something, there's a creator sitting there and tinkering. Every being who comes out is from the workshop, tapped and tinkered. I don't believe in such a God, let me tell you. Then there are others who think that God is sitting somewhere up there in heaven. I have nothing to do with such a God. It's useless for me. He's sitting there and I'm sitting here, so what? So, if by God you mean that there is a supreme, expansive, infinite reality which the senses cannot perceive, but which great rishis have touched, great teachers, great saints have touched at some point through their heart, then I believe that God exists, that God. Not this. Now in the present circumstances, the greatest God is one who is always there to help us. The capital G, Google. Google. In California, when I go, I also speak at Google. So, when we say God, we generally think of something that will give us something. It's a business. I go to Tirupati and offer a big brick of gold and expect that my bribery is not caught by the income tax. This is one kind of God. I also go to Tirupati. I'm not saying I don't, for a different reason. So, that's what I have to say. According to my understanding, the word God, it's better not to use it because it's been misused a number of times for thousands of years. I should say that it is that which can't be defined by man. When I say man, please, human being. It's that which is infinite and yet that which can be touched by the finite being. Provided one understands that the finite brain cannot touch it. And that if it is, it is all pervading and not sitting somewhere high up, cut off from everywhere else. If it is there, it is right here. Therefore, the Vedantins call such a being Antaryamin, one who sits inside your heart. If we are talking about such a God, I believe.
How do I deal with self-doubts when I'm on the spiritual path?
Good questions, all of them. How do I deal with self-doubts when I'm on the spiritual path? Now, they're going so little. So, when you are on the spiritual path, naturally you get doubts, no question. Because you are on largely unexplored territory. You are stepping onto largely unexplored territory. So it's very common, very normal that you have doubts. So how do you sort it out? I think personally, there are many textbooks and many scriptures and many writings on the spiritual path which you should study. You need not accept everything, but at least theoretically you should go through them. And whenever you get a chance, talk to people who you think, at least, have moved a little bit into this path, or who have walked on this path. Talk to them. And nowadays it may not be possible to actually talk, but email them. So emails are for males and females, for both, no problem. So email. So definitely you will have doubts, there is no question about that. Self-doubt is very much part of your growth. Don't get dejected by it. Don't think, oh no, it's all gone, I can't do this, I'll give up, so what? No, no, I'll play golf. You can play golf, there's nothing wrong with that. But I always tell people that the Bhagavad Gita, which is 18 chapters, is like the golf links. There are 18 holes, but it doesn't have the 19th hole, the watering hole. So if you stick to the 18, it's fine. So anyway, I'm suggesting that read the literature available. When you meet somebody who who you think or who you are convinced may be knowing some things, talk to them and try to figure out the answers to your doubts. Until you reach the ultimate, you are bound to have doubts. When you touch that, there are no more doubts. And if you by any chance think, I have touched the highest and still have doubt, you have not touched the highest. Thank you.
Can you activate all chakras through meditation?
Now wait a minute. Can you activate or now? Or later? You know what? First of all, let's understand this thing called chakra. What does it mean, the word chakra? In Hindi we know chakra. Chakra mein phas gaye. So some people in the name of chakras get stuck in the chakra. So we have to be careful about this. So anyway, a chakra means a wheel. That which rotates, which moves. And in the psychic field, in the mystic field, in the spiritual field, every human being, the physical and the psyche of every human being, has certain points in the system where the energies move in a circular fashion. These are called the chakras. Traditionally, according to the textbooks of Yoga Tantra, particularly Sat Chakra Nirupana, which Sir John O'Groff translated as the serpent power. You know about this interesting man called Sir John O'Groff. He was a judge of the Calcutta High Court. He got seriously interested during the British times. He got seriously interested in Yoga Tantras. There are two kinds of, there is a Tantra and there is Yoga Tantra. And he left home and he joined them. And he learned a lot. First he studied Sanskrit. He learned a lot. And he changed his pen name to Author Avalon. And wrote a couple of books which are very interesting for anybody who would like to explore. One is Introduction to Tantra, where you can read and get rid of the idea that Tantra is not having orgies in a cremation ground. Something else altogether. In fact, Tantra deals with this chakras. So anyway, in Sat Chakra Nirupana, this wonderful text describes the centers of energy movement in the human psyche and corresponding places in the physical body. So it starts with that which is at the bottom of the spine called the Mooladhara. Now the Mooladhara means the root foundation, the last part. It's the foundation. And this supreme energy is supposed to reside at the Mooladhara in a potential form for all human beings, male or female. And from there are other centers coming up to the Sahasrara, which is the seventh center. And these seven chakras also correspond with the seven colors and the seven sounds of music. In Indian classical music, Sa Ri Ga Ma Pa Da Ni. It's not the way to say that, of course. Then it becomes prose. Somebody, one of my friends came and said, well, I've just studied the Carnatic music for 6 months. I said, wonderful, so can you do it for me? He said, yeah, of course. What? Sa Ri Ga Ma Pa Da Ni Sa Sa Ni Da Pa Ma Da Ri Sa Da. Sa Ri Ga Ma Pa Da Ni Sa Sa Ni Da Pa Ma Da Ri Sa. See? So each tone touches each center from the Mooladhara to the Sahasrara. So, and these are the centers which are generally not active in most people. They are there, they are not active. And there are ways and means which I can't sit down here and talk about, by which they can be activated. And they have to be done carefully because they should be balanced. You can't afford to activate one at the cost of another because then your mind becomes unbalanced. It is also there. You have to be careful what you do. So if you have the method of doing it, basically some forms of meditation called chakradharana and so on, then it's possible to activate them, but it's best done under personal guidance. Unless we want to suddenly stick straw in our hair and walk around naked, it's better to have guidance, personal guidance. Because we're dealing with very powerful things.
Can one follow two different forms of kriya, or is it not advisable to mix two kriyas?
Yeah, I'm faced with this question many times. The question is, can one follow different forms of kriya, or is it not advisable to mix two kriyas? So let me tell you first what kriya is. Don't think that kriya is only that which I teach. I teach other things also. But when you say kriya, it simply means a technique. And the yoga shastras have innumerable kriyas. When I say kriya, I'm talking about that particular technique or tradition that has come down to me from a certain lineage. This is what I mean when I say kriya. But there could be other kriyas, many kriyas. So there is no harm, provided what does kriya do? Kriya basically is meant to clean up the nadis or the channels of energy in our system. So if some other kriya is there which is helping you to clean up the channels, you are free to do that. But then not a good idea to get all mixed up. You follow one. You know, in India we have a food called khichdi, rice and dal and everything mixed together. So then you are meditation practice would become a khichdi. Don't do that. If you follow that, follow that. I am in no great desire to convert everybody to my kriya. There is no such desire in me. So you don't have to follow one kriya. You can follow, provided it helps you through practice to clean up your channels. It gives you tranquility of mind. It makes you feel balanced. It doesn't make you lethargic and go into some form of inertia. If these things are not happening, you're free to practice any technique you want, which is kriya. Don't think that kriya means only one particular thing. I think I've answered this question.
Is there a link between yoga and a cure for various illnesses? Cancer, autoimmune disease, chronic illness?
Now, the yoga that I teach is not yoga therapy. They say that in yoga therapy, there are some ways and means to treat various illnesses. However, I feel personally that through the practice of yoga, if your mind becomes calm and quiet and tranquil, you attract a lot of energy from inside, which has infinite potential. And if you are a practice of yoga, you have to lead a moderate life. You won't be overindulging in anything. In that case, as a prevent you, I think it's one of the best. As far as if it's a cure for a specific disease, I would say that you'll have to consult a specialist in yoga therapy. As far as muscular diseases and things go, I think there are very many ways of working with yoga. But when it comes to cancer, autoimmune disease and chronic, as far as autoimmune disease, yogis believe it's been due to a disorder or unbalance of the pranas. So if you practice something that can put you back balanced, make your body healthy, it can resist the diseases. So autoimmune, yes. As far as cancer and chronic illnesses are concerned, they are specialized subjects. I don't want to make any statement on that for the simple reason. The danger is, there may be something there, but the danger is, suppose I have cancer and instead of taking serious treatment, I think I'm meditating, I'll be okay, but the end you have to again do the chemical process. But then it's gone too far. So, you see, one needs to take all claims with a pinch of salt. Especially nowadays, when there are so many healers, who generally healing the well-healed, not the poor. So, it may be a money-making process. So be careful what you do. Like the Arabs say, believe in God but tie your camel. A yogi is not an idiot. A yogi is one who is intelligent, who does his work carefully. So don't get caught up in too much. You can experiment, of course. If somebody has a strangulated hernia which requires immediate surgery, do you think that it can be done through yoga or chakra dharana? You'll be dead by then. No more meditation. You have to go to the surgery. So please balance your thoughts on this matter. Don't carry it to such exaggerated proportions. But I think if you follow yogic life as a preventive, it is excellent. This balancing of your centers and energies, it is great. Beyond that, there are yoga therapists who are specialists. You'll have to talk to them.
Similar question, is headstand advisable for someone who has undergone surgery?
This I have to tell you very. Not only headstands, there are some yogic exercises which you should not do if you are not having normal physical, if you have abnormal physical problems. This is what happens when yoga has become a mass phenomenon and people see it on TV. Can you imagine somebody with high blood pressure standing on his head? In 2 days you'll have a hemorrhage if it is not in 5 minutes. So these are all, see what happens in Sirsasana. Head down, stand, legs are up, all the blood concentrates here. Which is good from the yogic point of view. But suppose you have high blood pressure, what happens? You get a stroke, immediate stroke. So this has to be balanced. So please, if you have undergone multiple bypass surgeries and if you have high blood pressure, my specific advice is please don't do any headstands. Shirsasana or even Sarvangasana. Avoid. If you at all feel like doing a little bit of that, take your pillow off and lie down with your legs on a pillow. Give it a little bit of race. Don't do Shirsasana. Don't do any head down posture. Even too much bowing down is bad. This is practical, please. And if you have multiple bypass surgery, you certainly should not be doing headstands. When you are okay, maybe you can slowly try, but not now.
At the time of death, by chanting Sri Krishna's name, one can attain moksha. You had the privilege of Krishna darshan in Mahabharata. You left your body. Why did you choose to come back
from the expense of it? I choose not to answer this question. You know, it's a myth that when you're about to die, if you say Krishna, you'll reach heaven. It's a myth. I'm telling you, you can quote me to anybody you like. Can you lead a terrible life all your life and simply say Krishna when you die and reach heaven? I mean, just think about it. What an illogical thing. I might have seen Krishna, I might not have seen, that's a different matter altogether. So, there was this story of a man who was an oil monger, you know, who used to sell oil. He was a very miserly guy. It's good to have faith like that, so you'll have more peace when you die, but don't think. Okay, so, he thought, he had named his sons Narayana, Krishna, Vishnu, so that when he dies, he'll call them and then go to heaven. Unfortunately, when he was about to die, no Narayana, no, nobody came, none of his sons came. Only Lakshmi was with him, his daughter. So, and then when he was just dying, you know, your mind will only go back to what you're thinking all the time. Death, you cannot suddenly shift it to Krishna, it's not possible. Or anybody else, or Ram Ram for instance. You can't, because you'll only be thinking of what you've been already thinking. So, in this case, first he called Narayana, nobody came. And then nobody was there to call anyway. And then he saw that there was a lamp burning, and he was an oil monger. And the wick was burning bright. And just when he was about to die, the only thought that occurred to him was, why are they wasting the oil? So he said, cut the wick. And he died. So the story is, he was born as an oil wick. So you can't do that. I mean, even if it is true or not, that's not the question. You have to practice now to be able to think of something like that when you die. You cannot suddenly shift. Okay, that's my understanding of this matter. So they said, then why did you come back, and so on. Well, I have my own reasons, let's not go.
Now we are coming to multiple questions. When the seeker is ready, the master appears. How will the seeker know when the time is arrived and the guru is about to arrive? The second question is a repeat of the earlier one. What is your experience of being with Lord Krishna and the master?
So let's not go into the second question, it's largely speculative. So let's leave it there. Maybe I'm bluffing. Anyway, so the first question, when the seeker is ready, the master appears. We have read about this and heard about this. How will the seeker know that the teacher or guru has arrived or is about to arrive? A serious question, of course. When the seeker is ready, which means what? When you have reached a stage of aspiration to spiritual life, which is so urgent, and there is nothing more in your mind except that. You're not interested in anything except reaching there. All other thoughts are almost vanished from your mind. That is the definition of someone who is ready as a seeker. Not before that. And if that has happened, I can assure you 100% that the teacher will come from somewhere, or you will find him somewhere. And how do you know if it is about to arrive? That I can't tell you. There is no portent by which you know that the teacher is about to arrive. But please remember that when you are looking for a spiritual teacher and you are dying to find that, and you have no other interest in life, but you want a spiritual teacher, free your mind from your preconceptions of what you think is a teacher. If you think a teacher is going to come wearing just a kaupini and with matted hair, you may be wrong. There are many such people now who have not reached anywhere. So, a spiritual teacher can appear in many ways, in any way. If you are looking for a real spiritual teacher, get rid of the prejudice that you have developed in your mind about the definition of a teacher. Because when he appears, you may not recognize the teacher. That much you should do. And if you are a seeker, then if a time comes in your life where it's like a thirsty man looking for water, then I think sooner or later, the teacher will come and give you a drop of water. There's no question about it. That's my experience, my anubhava. And without that, I couldn't have moved anywhere myself. I acknowledge that. Why? Because at that point, it was like thirst. It's like, you know, once a teacher and a disciple were walking along, and the disciple told him, I've been with you for 13 years. Nothing has happened to me. I haven't found God. I haven't found moksha. Nothing has happened. So the master said, come. They walked into the river. The master caught the disciple's head and pushed it into the water. Disciple thought, maybe he doesn't like the question, so he's trying to drown me. So when the disciple thought that he's going to die, there's no, he needed a breath of fresh air more than anything else, he released it. So he put his head out and took a deep breath. He said, ah, wonderful. He said, you will get the spiritual experience when your desire for that is equivalent to the feeling you had when you were underwater and were looking for that single gasp of breath. So don't immaturely think you're ready and the teacher is not appearing. No, if you want to do yogasanas, you can find many teachers, I'm not saying that. Unfortunately, nowadays, there are more teachers than disciples. Seriously. A man went to a guru and said, sir, I want to become your disciple, so what am I supposed to do? He said, oh, that. You have to get up in the morning at 3 o'clock. He said, 3 o'clock, okay. Himalayas, okay. And then you should go have a dip in the Ganga. I said, my God, 3 o'clock, okay, fine, done. And then you have to clean the kutir with water. Then bring firewood, okay. And he's waiting to hear when you talk about some meal, nothing's coming. And then we'll have classes in the morning, from 9 to 12. On the Upanishads. And then, sir, then you can go out and beg for food. Okay? And then he said, enough. He stopped. He said, so what does it take to become a guru? But this is too much for me. He said, you have to just sit and bless people. He said, why don't you make me a guru? I mean, this is too much for me. So this is the condition that you see every corner. There are teachers, there are no disciples now. What do you do? So careful. Watch out, if you are really serious, one day somebody will press your doorbell. Open the doorbell and he'll say, here I am. I'm telling you, it could happen. But if it's a stranger, don't let him in nowadays. Dangerous times. Thank you.
In your book, Jewel in the Lotus, Babaji explains how to be alert. Do not strain, and but to relax and let the teaching sink in deep so that we have no more doubts. So we feel that we need to put an effort to be alert. How do we absorb your teachings fully without strain in a relaxed way?
Whoever wrote this, if you are in the audience, are you relaxed? Are you under a strain?
Relaxed.
So that's it. You got the secret. I almost knew who wrote this. So I thought he'll answer the question. Why should I ask? And Jay is his name, so he's victory all the time. So good.
This is again a multiple question. Whose job is it to expose fake gurus?
Not mine.
False gurus and now market themselves. How to know the true from the false?
Give me that.
How can we get enlightened without going into the universe?
Whose job is it to expose the fake? I don't think it's my job, so I'm not going to do anything on this. But there are enough people doing that. So I don't have to go into this at all. You go onto the YouTube and you see many false gurus, or I don't know what, but being exposed and so on. So, oh God, there is a false ring in the phone. I'm at a talk, we'll call back. Well, this is how you should talk to your wife. So, it's not my job. So don't worry about exposing false gurus. Try to find good ones. That's better. And there are so many fake and very few authentic. I don't know if you think I'm authentic. I'm thankful to you. False gurus may are using Baba. Yeah, that is true. You go into the internet, you find thousands of Babajis. What do you do? I'm sorry about this. if it is so. So don't go into the inf- First of all, what is written in the internet may not be true. Google can give you information, don't accept it at 100% valid. Please give it some benefit of doubt, please. So don't fall at every Babaji that you see. This you have to be careful. There is no need of somebody exposing gurus to do this. And how to get enlightened without moving to a cave in the Himalayas and continue to live day-to-day ordinary life? That is the whole purpose of today's talk. From the beginning I said, this is not for those who want to run away to the Himalayas. See, look, it's not possible under the present circumstances, first of all, for most people to go to the Himalayas. Even if you go to the Himalayas, you may not find anybody. So what is the point? So where you live in this life, if you can find a small corner in your house where you can sit for 15 minutes, that's your cave. If you like, you can decorate it with photographs of the snow-clad Himalayas and light some incense and feel your entering, because you go there, I don't know whether you may be misled or find somebody who thinks, who says, and then you come back totally disillusioned. So it's, there is no need to do that actually. And while living here, is it possible to do so? I think it is possible to do. But you have to be serious. So serious that in the midst of all activities, you should set apart at least that much you should do. 10 to 15 minutes in the morning before the day starts, where you can be by yourself and contemplate. This is very important. Don't say, oh, I have already attained there and so I don't know. You know, even I meditate every day, not because I need to at this stage, but if I don't do it, then everybody says, oh, we are also reached there. We don't want to do it. Why we are in Turiya? So please set apart a small part of your day, preferably in the morning, where you can meditate, then you don't need to really go to the Himalayas. But having said that, if you get a chance to go to the Himalayas, please go. But don't stay there. Anyhow, you can't stay there. You'll have to come back. So go and see and enjoy the snow-clad Himalayas. Only thing is, don't fall into a guru trap. Go and see. It's beautiful there. It's lovely. Go and see the ashramas, everything, and come back. If suppose somebody approaches you and says, I can guide you spiritually, keep your checkbook safe. So, thank you. Thank you very much. I think we have just handled enough questions. We don't want anything more. It's 8 o'clock. And so we started at 6:30. So you and I have been together from 6:30 to 8. It's 1.5 hours. More than this, it gets boring. So let's stop it. So thank you very much. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Tat Sat.